Virgin Valley Artists Association, welcomes you to the Art Box, recorded in our beautiful Mesquite, Nevada, and sponsored by the Virgin Valley Artists Association. Our association has something for everyone of all ages. Come and get creative with us at 15 West Mesquite Boulevard, or find us online at mesquitefineartcenter.com or on Facebook as Mesquite Fine Art Center, also on Facebook, The Art Box.
Mackenzie and
Megan Wright, W-R-I-G-H-T. So I know exactly where Mesquite is because I'm from a group, lived in Milford, Utah for 10 years. My husband's from right there. His family grew up in St. Hughes, originally from Perk in Utah.
Okay.
So I know right.
And you said it right.
Yeah.
So you know everything.
I know. Hurricane.
You're not from Hurricane, Utah.
Hurricane.
Yeah, so I know right where Mesquite is.
And it'll be noisy in the background, but it's a podcast. Oh, well. And we'll go as long as you guys want to.
Okay.
When you say, you know, we're done.
Okay.
So don't feel like we're keeping you here. Uh-oh, she's going to read off the whole thing.
Yeah, well, if you want, she said she wanted that one, so I want to make sure I did a good job
two,
on it.
Two.
Oh, you want both.
Hers was Tell Me How to Be a Poet.
Okay, roll it, Linda. This is always our hard part.
Steve, the theme of this year's Cowboy Poetry Gathering is generations. And we just saw a fantastic show with four outstanding, talented women.
Yeah, and we have Annie Mackenzie has graced us here, along with her sister, Megan Wright. And you guys are you're the young talent. That's what we were told. You got to get Annie Mackenzie because she's the young talent.
Oh, gosh, perfect. Well, I wouldn't be here without Megan. So I'm just grateful they keep inviting me back and that she keeps helping me with all of it.
Annie, you want to tell us a little bit about your life, how you got started with cowboy poetry? You had mentioned before you were involved with construction, teaching, ranch life as well.
Yeah, so I grew up on a ranch in Jordan Valley, you know, born and raised there. Loved helping out on the ranch when I was a kid and stuff, but there was always kind of, I guess, pressure to go to college and go get a real job, so to speak. So I did that. I went to school, and then I had a bunch of different jobs. I worked in an office, and I worked construction, and then I was a teacher in my hometown for a little while. That didn't last very long. And I kept coming back home. I would skip, you know, in the spring we have branding season. I would skip school and college to come home for branding season every year and just tell my teachers I'd do the work when I got back or do it while I was there if they'd give it to me early. You know, it was always kind of the priority and would come home whenever I could. And I finally just realized, like, ranching and being back on the ranch is where I want to be and what I want to do. Why don't I just go do that and make that my living?
Well, and Annie, she went to college and she got her degree. She, like, finished school. You know, she didn't just go and try it out for a second. I mean, she went. She played college basketball, she college rodeoed, and she was on high honors throughout her college career. What was your degree?
Liberal arts is what the...
Liberal arts.
Yeah.
She got her graduate degree in liberal arts. So, I mean, she didn't just go to school and then skip and come home. Like, she finished it. She's very proud of how well she did there.
I almost didn't. If my big sister, Emily, like, I had, I think, one more year or two more years, and I was like, I'm done. Like, I'm over school. I don't know what I'm going to use this degree for. I'm just going to go home. And my sister Emily was like, the heck you are. You are finishing school. And I'm like, all right, I'll finish. That's it.
And what school was that?
I went to Walla Walla Community College up in Washington, and then I went to Eastern Oregon University. Yeah.
Congratulations. That's a lot to be proud of. And you had mentioned before when you were a teacher, you prepped for classes, grades 7 through 12.
Yeah.
And two different subjects as well.
It was a lot. It was so much work. But my sister was right. Like, I had a lot of long nights and tear-filled nights trying to get all that work done and figure everything out on the fly, basically. But by the end of it, the kids, they really stepped up and were like, I don't know. You have to have the kids buy into a program like that. Like, if they don't think you care, they're not going to care and they're not going to put any effort in. And so the kids that were I was teaching, they bought in and stepped up and helped me out a bunch. And by the end of the year, it was pretty fun, and I was sad to see it go.
Was ag an elective?
Yeah, so the ag classes are all elective, but it's a ranching community, so most of the kids,
most of the kids take it. That's their way of life.
Yeah,
they all do it for the shop classes.
But for the ag side, like there's shop classes, and then we had a greenhouse so we had like those classes, and there was we did public speaking was a part of it, and there was so many different things I had to learn about, like days before the kids, and then try and present the material to them.
I'm so knowledgeable.
Yeah, I know everything. But I think what helped was I was pretty honest with the kids, like, I'm doing my best, but you know, if I don't know something, let's look it up, figure it out together.
And kids appreciate that.
Yeah,
I'm learning a lot this week. I'd like to know more about your ranch life, and you said you came back for branding season, so kind of describe to me, if you will, what kind of things you did on the ranch and how branding season worked.
We're pretty fortunate. We run most of our cows outside. That means they're just out on grass in the wintertime. We have some really good winter country down by the river. They run outside. Then we have some heifers. Heifers is a cow that hasn't had a calf before. So we feed those at the ranch and help them calve, make sure they don't have any problems. And then come springtime, we gather all the cows up out of the winter country and from the ranch and brand them, which is marking their ears, cutting little notches out of their ears, and a hot iron on their hip to mark them that they're ours, and so nobody else will take them. And then they get a bunch of vaccinations to help keep them from getting sick, which definitely, we had a bunch of calves that kind of were off in a far corner and they never did get their shots, and the sickness that ran through those calves dang sure made you appreciate those shots they get.
You just like the common cow ailments, and then we vaccinate against them just like you vaccinate your kid or whatever. So we vaccinate them, mark them for identification so we know they're our cows or whatever, but we get, you know, the kids, everybody gets involved, from grandparents to the little kids, and they're roping. We head and heel. Some ranches only heel, or some places just put them through like a shoot and brand them, but we head and heel, and the kids look for it.
Oh, they have a blast.
As much as the grown-ups do.
We used to, I don't know, it used to be like kids, like you could have like one or two kids roping, kind of the old school way, but now we have brandings that are just all kid brandings, so all the kids rope.
And all the grown-ups
work the ground.
They do the bad jobs, and we let the kids do
and the, let the kids the have the fun rope in it. It's a lot of fun. They're a blast.
So when you say head and heel, that's describing
where the ropes go. Yeah. So one guy throws his rope and catches the head of the calf, and then the other guy throws his rope and catches the two back feet.
Yeah. Okay.
And that way you can hold them on the ground; they won't struggle and hurt themselves as bad. And you can mark them so we can get them back if they get mixed with the neighbors.
Are the hours long during branding season?
Yeah, they can be. They can drag on. It kind of depends on how many cows they set out to do. But there's been days where we've branded like 500 head, and it's dark and everybody's tired.
Last year we got home at like it was a late branding. It was more like June, so you know you have too much daylight in a ranch. It's rough when you're hit June, July, and you get hours and hours of daylight.
No such thing as too much daylight.
But, I mean, we got home. I think we quit branding at like 10:30, 11 o'clock at night, and then had to drive, you know, an hour or two home and put horses away and put the vaccines and stuff. So
it was a long one.
I mean, we
and the calves are a lot bigger in June.
It
wears you out.
It depends. But I don't think there's not really such thing as short hours on a ranch. So it's whatever the season is, whether it's branding or haying season or in the fall, then we have to gather everything and sort them and take the babies away from their moms to wean them, you know. And so those days are long. And then in the winter, you're feeding everything and breaking ice for everything. And if any of the cows are having issues having their babies, you're helping them. So
There's
no short days on a ranch.
And there's always something to do. Like, do we have anything going on today? Is a dumb question. Like, yeah, we'll find something if we don't.
If you want to go to town, or Annie especially, if she wants to go to town, she doesn't say like, hey, what's going on? She's like, I'm going to town to get groceries.
Yeah.
Goodbye.
You can't say what do you got going on, because then you feel bad.
You'll
they're
never
doing
have
it.
Groceries.
Yeah, you'll never get groceries.
After 10:30, 11 o'clock at night, that's when you started your cowboy poetry.
Yeah, well.
So tell us about how you got into cowboy poetry?
I just always loved poetry. I thought it was great. Like, I went to school in a one-room schoolhouse, and my Aunt Rena was our teacher, and she was, like, very, I don't know what you would say the word is, like, high on, like, reading, writing, and arithmetic.
The three R's.
Reading, writing, and arithmetic. And she kind of ingrained that in me, and so I ended up loving reading and writing. And if I had a school assignment that I could turn into a poem, I would do it every time. I just loved it and always writing one. And I don't know. They just come throughout the day, and I scribble them down on whatever I can find.
So you started with poetry, and then you got into cowboy poetry?
Well, I guess kind of, yeah. I mean, they kind of went hand in hand. I wrote about loving where I live and loving my horse. And so, he's a great horse, of course.
I love that. That's one of your first poems.
Yeah.
Well, it rhymes.
Isn't that fantastic? So how did you get involved with the National Poetry Gallery?
Oh, I would say by accident. So I'd always wrote poems, but I didn't really share them with anybody except for, like, Megan. Like, I would tell Megan, like, oh, listen to this one or whatever. But I didn't post them anywhere. I didn't share them with anybody because I just thought, like, people probably think I'm a nerd writing poetry and what a dork.
She is a nerd.
Well, that's true. I just own it now.
Yeah, but look what this nerd does. You get up in front of all these people.
Oh, yeah.
And you're just like a natural.
I can't believe that. I still can't believe that I'm here. It blows my mind.
She wrote a poem about our brother that was teasing, you know.
Yeah. That's
worse. I was just telling one of our friends, nobody escapes Annie's pen. Nobody's safe. She wrote a pretty hilarious, a little naughty poem about my brother and shared it with the neighbor. And then he happened to have family associated with there and with the gathering.
Yeah.
And then he was like, well, you should talk to my aunt or whatever. And it just, all of a sudden, Annie was an Elko. And she was like, I don't know how.
Just sharing one funny poem around the campfire moving cows, and then all of a sudden they're inviting me to Elko. Like, oh snap.
What was your first time in Elko?
So that was it 2018, I think, was my first time in Elko.
Oh, wow. Yeah. So you're an old hand here.
Oh gosh, I don't know if I well, call it that.
There's a lot of old hands there, including me. I'm old, but you're not old. They're all like up and cover.
Yeah, so it's been crazy, but a lot of fun.
The show that we just saw, Rites of Passage, highlighted you and three other women. I wrote down a comment I'd like for you to share with our listeners. Tell us about how you feel about sharing artwork.
Oh, gosh. You said sharing your artwork is like sharing a piece of yourself. Is that what I
yes,
said?
Yes, yeah. That's what you said. Yes.
Yeah, I very much believe that. It's terrifying to get up there and share those, you know, those are my innermost thoughts, and it's like, I don't know, I'm not usually the one who does the talking, if you can believe it. Like, I usually leave that to the rest of my family. Usually Megan, like, someone will ask me a question and I'll like look at Megan like, how do I feel about this? So getting up there and sharing what I think and everyone is listening is terrifying, you know. Like, that's me. That's a part of me that I, in a sense, won't get back, because that privacy of that moment is gone and it's shared with everyone, and it's scary.
I think you said one time your art, how do you say that? It's, you know, sharing your poems and reciting them to be critiqued is like putting a piece of myself out there to be analyzed.
Oh,
I
yeah.
You said that
I did.
One time. It's like your poem's not just open
yeah,
for
it's not just
you.
The words that are like, it's especially when they're written on the page and you send it to somebody, you can separate yourself from it a little bit. Like, how do you like these words? It doesn't have anything to do with me, but when I get up there and share my words, then yeah, I open myself, my very self, up for that analyzation and critique. And it almost feels like if they don't like my poetry, they don't like me, because it's such a part of me. And it's
what I noticed on Rites of Passage was that your poetry was so honest and heartfelt. You shared some real pieces of your inner self with us, which was very much appreciated, I think, by the crowd. I wonder if you would go ahead and share your poem with us now. Tell me how to be a poet.
Oh, yeah. That one was, oh my gosh, I was not sure if I wanted to share it or not, because I was really terrified somebody would take it the wrong way. Like, I was...
You didn't want to offend somebody who helped you.
Yeah, somebody would help me, like, oh, she didn't even appreciate my help. But I so appreciate everyone's help that's ever just even given me a small comment, like, slow down when you're talking, which I still need to work on. But...
Oh, we get our critiques.
Good. I take all critiques. I'm open to all.
My critique is from my oldest son, Dad, don't talk anymore. Let Linda talk. Let Linda say everything.
Stop.
Oh, gosh.
Like, don't be so mean to me,
yeah,
son.
Yeah, it's just hurtful. But, yeah, so I was terrified to share this one, but I'm glad that I did, because it was something that, especially preparing for this gathering, you know, coming back to all the crowds and stuff and being around so many great poets, it's intimidating. And so this is my experience with trying to get better and struggling with how to do so.
Sure.
Tell me how to be a poet, who I ought to copy, who to not. Tell me how to be a poet, how I should be like the old ones, lest they're forgot. Tell me how to be a poet. Tell me how to write. Tell me how to be a poet. Tell me how to recite. Don't rhyme the words I use in everyday life. They're too common, too plain. Don't write about my struggles and strife, if someone else has had that pain. Slant rhymes are too uncouth, a lazy author's out. Find another word to use. I should be better at it by now. Tell me how to be a poet, if it's all been written, already put in prose. Tell me how to be a poet. All the good ones were written years ago. Tell me how it's done, how to stand, how to talk. Tell me how I'm not one. I'd understand. I won't balk. You tell me how to be a poet. Lord, I guess I'm not one. Maybe I should have quit it for all this nonsense begun. I'll tell you, I just like pretty words. I like them better when they rhyme. I never was the one who said they're worth a dime. I'll tell you, I write about it if I know it. About the cattle and the land. I'll tell you, I never wanted to be a poet. I just wanted to be a cowhand.
That's fantastic. Yes. The other thing we talked a little bit about before we started the podcast is that you were very open in front of the crowd. You had a challenge, and you said, if this would help anybody in the audience, I'd like to share this poem. And Steve and I gave you a standing ovation for that poem.
Yeah, that was very much appreciated. It was hard to share that one.
Would you please share a little bit with us that your poem about your struggle with depression?
Yeah.
And you can or not, whatever you want to do.
Yeah,
don't let us.
That's
and share the helpline that you.
Yeah, I was, like I said, I was worried about sharing it at all, and I didn't know if I could, basically, I guess, because it's
very raw.
Very raw. Yeah. It's very what I just was struggling with and, like, trying to go through these things, and I never wrote it to be shared. I didn't count the stanzas and the syllables and the lines and rhyme everything perfectly. I just kind of let it all come out of me, and it was a really dark time when it came, and I for a while there, I was just, like, kind of trying to ignore it. Like, that's not what it was. Like, you're just having a bad day, and just get over it and you'll be fine. And then I remember feeding in the tractor one day, and I don't know what the tipping point was, but I do remember getting out of the tractor, and Megan was helping me. I think you were opening gates and I was in the tractor, and I got out of the tractor and I was like, I can't do this anymore. I'm tired of life. I don't want to do it anymore. I can't handle it. I don't see the point. I don't care about anything. I don't want to try for anything. And it was just even saying it out loud made it so much better, just to get that off my chest. Because I had been fighting it, and, I mean, fighting and fighting and fighting it. And I knew Megan could see it. Like, everybody on the ranch could see it. But I refused to talk about it. I didn't want to bring it up. And so when I finally was like, talked to her and was like, I am depressed. I can't just keep pretending I'm okay. I am struggling with depression.
And I was like, no crap.
And Megan's like, obviously.
And that's a real illness, like heart disease, cancer.
I mean, it's just...
But some people don't realize that.
It's not just a bad day. Like, it's your whole body chemistry fighting against you and stuff.
And our Western lifestyle, I mean, they do not talk about it ever. Mm-hmm. There's actually another poultry community that they're trying to bring awareness to suicide and depression in the Western lifestyle. And how people just, I mean, you don't talk about it. I mean, if Annie was to, and my grandma's like super awesome, but I think if Annie even tried to talk to our grandma about it, she'd be like, no, you're fine. You're fine.
Yeah.
That's just how different. It is. It's, and that's how our family is. That's how the culture is. It's not, it's insane. The amount of people that are just like, if you're depressed, that's, you're weak. You're just. Need to get over it. You don't need therapy. You don't need help with chemical imbalances. That's if your body has an issue and it's not taking care of itself. Like you need medicine. You need a doctor to help you. And they're just like, nope.
Yeah, everything's fine.
Nope, you're fine.
And that's part of the real struggle too with cancer. You get a lot of sympathy and empathy and help.
Yeah.
And with depression. A lot of people don't understand.
Yeah, they'll avoid you. They don't want to. Yeah. Like
it's not
like,
contagious.
It's not contagious, but they just like they don't want to confront that issue or like maybe think about their own issues with it. So they like I got. I know I was avoided by people, and I kind of like hurt, but I was like also. I could see why. Like it made them uncomfortable, and they didn't know how to handle it or what to do. And I was still trying to figure out what the hell to do. So I could. See it, but yeah, they just you don't get the like that same support or whatever. People just kind of like, I guess they feel like if they don't bring it up, like bringing it up makes it worse or something. But it's very much freeing when you can just say it, like I am struggling with depression and I need to go get help. And I went to BetterHelp.com and got a therapist, and I could because I live super remote, so I was able to call them and talk to them on the phone whenever I needed to and. They could help me through it.
Would you repeat that again?
BetterHelp.com.
BetterHelp.com.
Yeah. Okay. So they do, like, you can do online email or whatever and text or call or whatever works for you.
Video call.
You can do video calls and stuff, yeah. So being so remote, it was awesome that I could set it up
and
on my schedule.
They set you up with,
They match
that
you with
like
someone.
Sound like a commercial.
Yeah,
form,
we do. I should be getting paid for this. They match you with a therapist who has.
A quiz? Right?
Yeah, they have you answer these questions about your faith and you know what you're looking for help with and who you are and where you're at in your life or whatever, and then they find a therapist who specializes in that or has similar values as you, and it's awesome.
And I'm sure you feel stronger having to overcome that challenge.
Yeah,
stronger than if you had. Never been confronted by that
oh
challenge.
For sure. And I definitely still struggle with it. Like there's still days where I just don't want to go and like I don't see the point or whatever, but I know that I've been through the darkest part and I know I can come through it again.
Right.
It's hard and it's never easy to deal with those thoughts, but I know I can do it because I've been through the darkest part already.
And you were able to open up to a stranger and a therapist and help. You know what I mean?
Like yeah.
You know how to get help now.
Yeah.
You took that very giant, very hard, very difficult, very suck you down step to say, I need him.
Yeah. That was the biggest thing. I need help. I can't do this. And saying it out loud to somebody was, like I said, so freeing. Like I was able to let that go out of me instead of just fighting it in my head. Just that came out and it was, yeah, very freeing.
And then you took the huge step of sharing that with your audience.
Yeah, that was terrifying.
Do you feel like sharing that home with our podcast listeners?
Yeah, I can do that.
That would be great.
I need to go get some more tissues.
Yeah, where's your scarf? I'm tired all the time. I can barely get myself out of bed. But the responsibility's mine and the critters still need fed. Brush it off as sometimes I sing the blues. 'Cause depression is a word that cowboys don't use. I need to move my cows, they're running short on feed. I need to shoe my horses, they've all got long feet. I need to let my dogs out, had them kenneled for 2 weeks. But I can barely find the energy, struggling in this muck like a yearling in a sluice. But depression is a word that cowboys don't use. And I've seen other cowboys struggle with this affliction, masking their hurt and brokenness with all kinds of addiction. Yeah, he kind of lost it. He went off the deep end, became an alcoholic, and lost all of his friends. Maybe he just didn't know what else to do. 'Cause depression is a word that cowboys don't use. Mental health just means you're really good at math. And you should just get over it if you're ever feeling sad. Cowboys don't cry. Pull yourself up by the bootstrap. There are well-intentioned lies that'll catch you in this trap. If you can't be honest about what it is you face, how do you intend to ever escape? It's a vicious cycle of self-inflicted abuse. But depression is a word that cowboys don't use.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Annie. Thank you very much. Let me ask, so does being on stage, does that help? And the adoration of millions?
Yeah, no.
Wait till our millions of listeners.
Yeah, right? No, adoration does not cure that, no. For sure. But it is like, it was amazing because I think I almost, felt like I was about to cry on stage. Like I was really struggling with that many people staring at me, you know, and sharing like this thing that you're so used to hiding from everybody.
Your secret.
Yeah, basically your secret. And so sharing it in front of all those people was so terrifying, but I just kind of had this sign from God. I had seen a post somebody else had made about depression in the Western community. And I was like, and I was, you know, looking at that poem and then had seen the post. And I was like, yeah, I'm pretty sure that's a sign from God right there. Like, they shared this and it helped you. So if you share your story, it will help others. I think sharing leads to healing when we can all come together and admit like we're all struggling with different, you know, with these things, and it's okay.
And it may have touched others. I'm sure it did touch many others in that audience who are struggling.
Yeah, I had some people come up to me and they thanked me for it. And so that made it worthwhile, the almost breaking down and shaking and...
I couldn't even get her out of the room for your to come do this, because it was, I mean, there were so many people that came up and were just like, that was,
yes,
powerful. That was something, you know. So very proud of her for.
We'll change the subject here a little bit. They're doing a wild horse roundup and how terrible it is on the horses and everything. Do you want to talk about that?
Yeah,
what
I would
you
love
do?
Dude, that's another thing I feel pretty strongly about, because there's so much, I don't know, misinformation out there, I guess. People just think they're rounding them up for fun or something, but they're tearing their own environment apart. Like the way horses are built, like they're kind of an invasive species. They weren't here, and the way their hooves are just tears the land apart, and they have too many of them. They don't have any predators that do population control, so there's too many horses. Like there's supposed to be like 70,000 in the entire United States, I think, is what their allotments they have, the BLM does. Like our land can handle this many animals, and there's, I think, three times that, or...
Oh, yeah.
It's got to be more than three times that, what they have. There's, I think, 200,000 or something. There's a, it's a crazy number. You, like, I don't want to give you the wrong number and be able to make a liar out of myself.
If you go out like Pahrump or somewhere and see the horses out there, and we've done jobs with, we've gathered and stuff there, but they're just, they populate so quickly.
They're like rabbits.
Oh
my gosh.
And the horses you see there, it's so sad. Like, we love horses.
Yeah.
Love horses. They're not just a tool for our work, you know, but they're, so to see an animal that's starving and
starving to death. Like, they are,
I mean,
they don't have enough grass and water. They have eaten the, you know, wrecked the country so much. They have starved themselves to death.
And if it weren't for ranchers, they would even be worse off, because a lot, like, especially out there, there's no water, you know. So the ranchers haul water to their cows, which then the horses get to drink the water, you know. But it's so sad. I hate the wild horse stigma of don't wrangle them, because if you ever actually go out there and see the ones that are starving to death, that their colts are, they just have to leave their colts and walk away because they can't raise them. They have no milk.
They'll wean their colts and they'll
leave their colts at a dry
because they can't survive.
It's super sad. I the wild
it's
horse.
It's awful.
Yeah, and I've seen them around. Sad. Well, if you know about Pahrump, then you know about I think it's Cold Creek.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And we've seen them there. My wife and I have gone up to take pictures of them and seeing the ribs and everything.
Yeah.
You know, and then you'll hear they're doing a Roundup, and then some other, well, they're doing a Roundup, but what else can they do?
Because they're going to die. They get, you know, they round them up and they either ship them to like a feedlot type area, or there's ranches, like especially in like Oklahoma, Kansas area, that's where they get to go live, and they have like first cutting grass, feed and grain,
horse
and water,
heaven,
and vet, you know, they get taken care of by a vet, and it's Oregon's kind of different, because our horses in Oregon are managed quite a bit better than Nevada, and Utah. So we have like beautiful Mustangs. Like, you go up there, there's some big horses. They're really good looking. So they see them and they're like, oh, they're free and you're taking them. Like, yeah, but if you don't, they're going to end up looking like the ones in Nevada and the ones in Utah that are starving and what is it?
Emaciated?
Yeah, no, like there's not enough variety to the horses, so they're all
inbred.
Inbred.
They're super inbred.
So they have so many health issues from that.
Yeah.
It's, I don't know. I guess when you come from like ranching or a Western way of life, you kind of live in a world of harsh truths, and people who, you know, they don't live out there where the horses are, they don't see that every day. And so they just think, you know, it's all sunshine and butterflies and just leave them alone and they'll be fine. And it's like, no, I don't, like, how do you, would you rather them starve to death, or would you rather them be gathered and like the numbers managed to where they can thrive and be healthy, and you can gather them and get the numbers down to where Oregon is at a little bit better, you know, and they have better horses that people want to purchase, so you can keep the numbers down through a purchase option. Like, it's hard to find people to buy inbred
donkeys
from Nevada because
their health issues are alone.
Yeah. You can't afford to take that horse on. You can't afford to pay for him.
Yeah,
and we have the donkey rescue right around the corner from us in scenic Arizona.
Yeah,
and that's the same thing. I mean, if you don't take care of them, I mean, that's, I think, God, like, you know, we're very much Christian based, and I mean, I think that's why God made man, was to be the caretakers of earth and to take care of the animals, and we just want to do that to the best of our abilities, you know. And when people don't see the flip side of like Roundups and stuff, they're just like, leave them alone, take the cows off. That's another thing, just take care of the cows, no more ranchers, just wild horses. It's like,
it's not the cloven-hoofed animals that are causing
the
detrimental
damage.
Well,
and it won't solve anything. Those horses will just keep populating and keep populating and keep populating. And
like, it's not a solution.
Yeah.
It'd be like, oh, take the deer and elk off so the horses can... Well, that's not going to do you any good either. Like, they don't want to... I don't know. They just see, like, the horses running with their mane in the wind, and they're so beautiful, and how dare you ever interrupt their life, like... You don't see them laying down dying.
All of my photographer friends who spend all their time up there fowling, taking these beautiful pictures.
They are, and I enjoy them myself, but I just, like, I know that I've personally seen
the other side of it,
and it's so frustrating. People fight so hard and spend so much money suing the government or suing the ranchers for the sake of the horses, and it's like, The road to hell was paved with good intentions.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And that's, I mean, they're just driving those horses.
Sorry, you totally hit a topic.
Yeah, Annie, who started the whole thing. Yeah. So I've been called that my whole life. And like, listen, the wild horses are a problem.
Well, when you mentioned about, I read it in there about horses.
Yeah. And that's so like.
Now we'll get Lillian to listen to this.
Oh, she'll probably hate me. Lillian, I'm so sorry.
We're not attacking you.
I'm not a horse hater. I love them, but I want the best for them, but not wrangling them is not the.
Oh, yeah.
It's awful for them.
To see a horse starve. When they, you know, gather and some of those horses can't even make it to the pen.
They can't even walk.
They're so, it's disgusting. I can't handle an animal or person suffering. I just can't. And to see the wild horses when they're not managed is so difficult for us.
Steve, yeah. I'm learning a lot. Tell us about what the future holds for you and more cowboy poetry here, I hope. What, you have some gigs going on? What's going on?
Oh, this is kind of the one gig I make it to. The stress of preparing for this one about takes me out.
You're very good. I would never guess that.
Gosh.
Would you, Steve?
I would know. You get up like you've been doing this your entire life.
Yes.
Oh, it doesn't feel that way. But no, this is pretty much the only one I do. I've done a handful of other ones, and I've kind of, I don't know, played with the idea of doing some more, but poetry is very much kind of a hobby that I love, and I get kind of wary of turning it into a job because I really, you know, I love ranching and doing all those things and writing my poems about them, but sitting down and be like, okay, I have to write a poem about a horse and a saddle and, you know, those kinds of things, like it just turns it into a job for me, and then I absolutely hate the poem.
We could talk to you for hours and hours because we've had the artist thing of, is it a job? You started with our artist in Alaska, and she was saying, well, it's work. And you say, oh, it's work. And now you're saying, oh, it's work.
Yeah, I don't want to turn it into that. I want to keep it this fun, you know, I don't know,
Well,
not job.
Well, Annie could never make it a job. Like, you know, she does, these poems just come to her when the people she's around or the job she's doing.
Someone will say a phrase, and then there's
that,
the poem.
You know, if she was to have, to sit down and be like, I have to write this. It wouldn't have the realistic, you know, this is her life that you get to, sorry, Annie.
You're good.
This is the life she's sharing. This is her, and it's like her, you know, to have to make something. I don't think that's Annie. It would take away everything her poems are.
I agree. That's why we grabbed her here for a podcast. Annie, thank you so much for being with us today. And
yeah, I hope I was good.
You were fantastic. And Megan, you're her support person. Thank you so much for being here with us as well.
Couldn't do it without her.
Yeah, we really appreciate it. You guys have made our day.
Oh, good. Well, so.
Well, you're
mine.
Easy to please.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, we'll let you get back to more of the Cowboy Poetry Gathering.
Thanks, guys.
We were so lucky to have Annie come by and do an interview with us. She's quite amazing, as well as her sister Megan. We thought we would end with one of her poems that we recorded during one of her live sessions. We attended three. I forget which one this was from, but it's really cute. Thank you, Annie. Thank you, Megan.
This kind of all came flooding to me at once. But when the first tickling of the poem came to my mind, I thought, this is inspired work. And I'm going to be reading this at church. But that is not the poem that I wrote. This is what I got. I went up Spring Mountain the other day. I was out there on my own, searching for a blind calf so I could bring him home. I found him fairly quickly, but just as quick he went astray. Because even though he couldn't see, he thought he knew the way. He veered off the path of hare into a rocky deep ravine, but as soon as I fetched him out of there, he was nowhere to be seen. He'd beaten me to the top, and he was fast on better ground. So I went back across the rocks, see if he could be found. Now I won't lie to you, it weren't a rosy search for the blind one, and I'd have punched him on the nose if only I could find him. Thankfully, my brother showed up. Boy, I'm glad he did, because I was ready to have a tantrum that would rival any kid. Through poorly disguised mirth, He helped me with the search and got the calf back on the trail. My brother said to rope him. That also gave me hell, with a whole lot of cursing and a little bit of luck. Finally, I caught him, got him loaded in the truck. I look back on that day as I drove off that mountaintop and pondering that calf's lack of faith, I lost myself in thought. I guess you could compare this story to Christ when his lost children roam. But I hope he doesn't use the words I did while trying to bring that bastard home.
We want to thank the National Endowment for Humanities and Nevada Humanities for sponsoring our trip to the 38th National Cowboy Poetry Gathering.
Broadcasting from Mesquite, Nevada, in the scenic Mojave Desert, the Art Box sponsors thank you for listening. To find our next and past podcasts, find us online at mesquitefineartcenter.com, where all accompanying images and links are available on the Art Box page. Questions, comments, opinions, and concerns can be sent to artboxvv@gmail.com. The views and opinions expressed in this podcast are solely those of its hosts and guests and do not necessarily reflect the views and opinions of the Virgin Valley Artists Association.